Those of you who have been to the ENOJP meetings before will know everything you need to know about Raquel, but for those of you who are meeting her for the first time, she's a professor at the University of Pompeu Fabra in Barcelona, Spain, where she did her PhD thesis on Nishitani. And she came to Japan, I think the first time in 1999, actually with two of her professors, and we spent some months going over line by line her translation of Nishitani's book on religion and nothingness, which came out later that year. The following year, Ueda went to, Ueda Shizuteru went to Spain, and she got to know him and his work. And a few years later, in 2004, she put out a collection in Spanish of his essays, which actually sold out inside of 3 months. And now she's preparing, with others, a further collection of essays of Ueda, this time, I believe, in English. In addition to all of her own writings, she translated the, or was coordinator and translator of the source book of Japanese philosophy into Spanish. And she just finished a work which is already printed but will not be published officially until next month. Tom Kasulis's 800-page short history of Japanese philosophy. So I'm not sure where she finds all the time to do this with two young children to raise, but everyone in the Spanish-speaking world, in the second language of the Western Hemisphere, who has anything to do with Japanese philosophy, knows who Raquel is. And those of you who don't, very soon will understand why she is as important as she is. So, Raquel. Oh.
Well, thank you so much, too kind. Indeed, there is 20 years since I first came to Nansen, and hospitality and friendliness remain intact. And this is now also 5 years since our first ENOJP meeting conference took place. And I think we should congratulate ourselves for creating such a space of learning, exchanging opinions, and sharing time together. I think it is emblematic that the conference this year takes place precisely here in Shugunken, or Nansan Daigaku and Shugunken Institute, because of the role that this institution has played in the dissemination of Japanese philosophy, thanks especially to, or particularly to, James Heisig. So thank you so much for inviting me, the organizing committee, or inviting me for giving this presentation today and open session. And let me also say that my title and content of the presentation has changed a little bit since I submitted the abstract and title, but the original main points probably will be mostly the same. I would like to start by remembering Ueda Shizuteru, precisely, who, as you may know, recently passed away. In 2006, Ueda-sensei took part in the biannual Haas lectures in Barcelona. On that occasion, the Chilean artist Fernando Prats presented an exhibition entitled Basho, the Savage Region, in allusion both to the central concept in Nishida's philosophy, Basho, or place, and to what Merleau-Ponty calls Region Savage, the untamed or savage region of the self, that is, a realm of experience not yet embraced by our culture and not yet interpreted by our culturally determined and formed language. According to Merleau-Ponty, we can communicate with other cultures through this savage region, which is at our disposal as a new organ of understanding and incorporating in our own culture. In fact, in one of his writings, Ueda introduced this expression to suggest that the notion of pure experience in Nishida may resemble that wild region that can only be reached by breaking through the hardened shells of our own cultural forms. The above mentioned lectures were devoted that time to mysticism East and West. And the artist Fernando Prats wanted to evoke as this place as this sort of place as an occasion for mutual encounter and understanding. At that time, the essential elements of Fernando Prats' work were inspired by a visit he had paid to the Department of Geology at the University of Chile. There he was able to see a smoked paper seismogram that had recorded the 1960 Valdivia earthquake in Chile, which measured 9.6 in Richter scale. The seismogram included smoke or soot, the fixing of the smoke onto paper, a linear energy that expressed the internal movement of the Earth, and thus, before the lectures started, Prats had left a smoked paper on the floor for this installation to be presented the next day. It came as a surprise that during the opening of the installation, Ueda Sensei kneeled down and drew a picture in the corner of the smoked paper. Then he took off his shoes, entered the installation, gave a few steps, and then, joining his hands, bowed, turned, and went back outside. What he drew was a circle, a triangle, and a square. The circle, triangle, square is Sengai's picture of the universe. Sengai Gibbon was the abbot of Sofokuji, the first Zen institution established in Japan in 1195, and this information about the temple is precisely what the calligraphy in the picture show. The paintings of this Zen monk and artist are known for their simplicity and sense of humor. Shortly before his death, Daisa Tsuzuki wrote a work on Sengai. Tsuzuki interprets Sengai's universe as follows. The circle represents the infinite, and the infinite is at the basis of all beings. But the infinite in itself is formless. We humans, endowed with senses and intellect, demand tangible forms. Hence, a triangle. The triangle is the beginning of all forms, we could say the individual. Out of it first comes the square. A square is a triangle doubled. This doubling process goes on infinitely, and we have the multitudinosity of things, which a Chinese philosopher called the 10,000 things, that is the universe. A circle turns into a triangle, and then into a square, and finally into infinitely varied and varying forms, figures. End of quote. With a few strokes, the artist captured in this picture a sort of cosmic harmony, and at the same time replicated the spirit of the universe through his own creative act. The three figures are not separated but interconnected. The circle and the triangle intersect, forming an empty space. The triangle enters the square, and the thickness of the stroke decreases, leaving blank spaces in the square outline. Blank spaces dominate the surface of the canvas, but the blank space is not a mere background either. Rather, it is expressed by the form of the things depicted. As the philosopher Gian Giorgio Pasqualotto notices, these forms, are they symbolic meanings, can be found in other widespread symbolic forms, as the yantra and mandala in Hinduism and Buddhism, where the square symbolizes the earth as having no definite form is the unformed materiality, the triangle, the manifestation previous to the forms, and the circle, the original unity that embraces all forms. From an intercultural perspective, I have had the other picture, because interestingly, the medieval thinker Raimundus Lullius, in his work Nova Geometria, speaks of the full figure, the figura plena, which according to him emphasizes the plenitude, the fullness of being, and could be depicted like this. But in any case, Suzuki also relates the three figures to Shingon and Zen as Buddhist traditions familiar to Sengai. I quote, "He, Sengai, liked Shingon because it taught the identity of the bodily existence, Upakaya, with the ultimate reality, Dharmakaya. The bodily existence is here represented by a triangle which symbolizes the human body in its triple aspect, physical, oral or intellectual, and mental or spiritual. The quadrangle represents the objective world, which is composed of the four great elements, earth, water, fire, and air. And the Dharmakaya, the ultimate reality, is the circle here. This is the formless form again." And then Suzuki adds, "We generally hold a dichotomous view of existence, form and formless, rupa, arupa, object and subject, matter and spirit, and we think they contradict each other and are mutually exclusive. Both Shingon and Zen, however, oppose this view and hold that what is form is formless or empty, shunya. That is, they are identical." And certainly, according to the classic Buddhist cosmology present in Abhidharma literature, the universe is made up of a set of mountains, oceans, and continents inhabited by sentient beings and divided into six realms. Mount Meru lies at its center, an axial mountain with multiple levels. Despite the Buddhist art was an iconic at the beginning in its origins, soon developed its own artistic and iconographic forms, including the universe and its three regions: the sensual domain, kamadhatu, and desire; the pure form domain, rupadhatu; and the formless domain of desire, or the formless domain, or arupadhatu. The doctrine of the dharmadhatu, absolute reality, which embraces all phenomena, is also central to the school Huayan, known in Japan as Kegon. This Chinese school, following the Avatamsaka Sutra, teaches that the deluded people fail to see the absolute reality, which is emptiness, because we see each phenomenon as individual and independent. Instead, every phenomenon is interpenetrated without obstruction with other phenomena, and thus it contains all other phenomena in itself. It is usually represented or expressed with the image of Indra's net, but here I choose this one. It is a Hawaiian mural painting depicted for visual and ritual practice. It is from the perspective of the awakened people, as Suzuki remarked in the reference to Shingon and Zen, that emptiness and the phenomenal world of forms can be seen as only one unique reality. And precisely, the Gandha Vyuha, the final part of the Avatamsaka Sutra, together with other Buddhist texts, like Lalita Vistara or the Jatakas, seems to have served as the basis for the iconography of the reliefs of Borobudur Temple in Java, Indonesia, as it is well known. Illustrating the Bodhisattva's path, although not exactly the three regions of the universe, as it is widely assumed, as for example in this picture, Borobudur Temple constitutes a guide for a spiritual journey of the pilgrims. The panels featuring the text chosen for illustration were laid out in a carefully designed sequence in order to create a continuous narrative of gradual progress of spiritual development and increasing detachment from earthly bonds. Let us now summarize the main points I would like to make up to now. First, in Sengai's picture of the universe, the aim is not to portray the form of things in the world, but their appearance out of the formless world. The universe is depicted in a very stylized and abstract form in an attempt to reduce the cosmic process to its essence. Its continuous movement is evoked by means of the resolute and dynamic gestures of the artist drawing the strokes. Here we have a fine example of how the artistic creative process mirrors or reflects the cosmic process. Second, Suzuki's interpretation introduces two significant concepts, the form and the formless. The formless form, important both in Buddhist traditional thought and aesthetics and in modern academic philosophy, like in Kyoto School philosophers as Nishida Kitaro, Hisamatsu Shinichi, Nishitani Keiji, and Ueda. Third, Borobudur Temple demonstrates the aesthetical potential of Buddhist art in the double sense of aesthetical, aesthesis, and sensory apprehension. Of course, we cannot speak here of aesthetics, in this context at least, in the sense in which the term is related to the various theories that try to identify the conditions, the conditions of possibility of value judgments of, on works of art or theories of beauty. We cannot forget the Western origins of the term, coined by German philosopher Baumgarten, as Professor Behme recalled the other day, and the definitive orientation that the discipline that Kant gave to the discipline in his critique of the faculty of judgment. Here, I would like to understand aesthetics not only in reference to the artistic experience, but as a reflection about sensation and perception. And since we deal with a context in which beauty manifests itself, where there is no contraposition between subject and object, as we will see, aesthetics refers also to the Greek sense of askesis as discipline, in this case oriented towards the suppression of the self. On this basis, I would like to deal with the philosophical problem that Nishitani Keiji calls the paradox of representation. I will address the process of decreation, or in terms of images, disimagination. As a part of the creative process itself, and as a way of dealing and perhaps solving this dilemma. And by so doing, I propose to reflect on some traits of Japanese arts that underline the limits of language and words for representing reality, and images, of course. Images and words understood here as limited forms of figures for expression. While these kind of arts at the same time develop interesting strategies for expressing reality without representing it, but actualizing it. To introduce the notion of Entbildung, let me first use another example of a creative process from the formless form to the form, interpreted from a Christian Neoplatonic perspective that can be contrasted with Senghi's picture of the universe. John Scotus Eriugena, work Periphyseon, or the Divisione Naturae, inspired this image. He was an Irish man who lived in the 9th century. He knew Greek and translated into Latin the pseudo-Dionysian writings. According to him, nature consists of all things which are visible and things which are not visible. Things which are and things which are not. He divided the former in four groups: the creating and not created, which is God as a source of all, and since, of course, God is unknowable and nothing can be predicated of him, he's best defined by negative than positive statements. This is the basis for negative or apophatic theology. And this is why in this image there is no depiction of God as this kind of nature, creating and not created. He is not here, like that, represented. Second, created and creating. The primordial causes, which as theophanies are eternal. In the center, in the middle of the image, there is bonitas, the good, but there is also veritas, ratio, virtus, justitia, essentia, vita, sapientia. These are the primal causes of everything in the whole universe. They are calling Greek ideas. The unity is the divine word or logos, the instrument of God's creative power. Third is created and non-creating, the created universe or all that it is known in generation, in space and time. Maybe can you read locus and tempus in the image? Are the elemental qualities upon whose interrelations the whole order of creation is built from the highest to the lowest, and from here derive all the elements. And fourth and last, the not creating and not created nature. It means God as the end of all. As it was the beginning, now is the end, but it's not merely a linear path, since as the whole creation came from primordial causes, so it will return to them. The expansion of the one into the all and its rotation back into the one, exitus and reditus, is the theme of the work precisely. The formation of images, which are imago Dei, images of God, lies between the formless origin and the formless end for creation to happen. God manifests through the visible, and creation is an image of his being. The Genesis is a display of images of what was previously imageless, to allow human being to find his own true image. This picture synthesizes the Platonical or Neoplatonical ontological hierarchy as a continuity or emanation with the iconic turn of Christianity after the biblical prohibition of images. Why? Why or what better was wrong with images in a time where images were not made for aesthetic pleasure but for worship? Why God was not represented, and when the iconic turn of Christianity happened, why Eckhart talks about Entbildung. Mr. Eckhart speaks of Entbildung or disimagination, as can be translated, as a process by means of which imagination of the soul detaches itself from representation, that is, frees itself from images to ascend to God. Literally means Entbildung, dissecting or dispossessing an image. It's the representation, or simply this imagination. According to Wackernagel, who is a scholar who has studied most Eckhart's theory of image, in Eckhart, Bildung or Bilde, image includes three semantic levels at least, to define the relationships between the divine God and the created being. It's word image, the logos, the presence of the image in the created person as imago Dei, and finally impressions of inner life and dissimilar images that make up the exterior world and concern the world of perception. It's the last one, it's precisely Worris Eckhart. Thus, if building formation has a positive evaluation in Eckhart, because it's similar to the divine or acquired formation, a form, and building is the result of a negative evaluation of the image, since it designates a dispossession of what is not divine, what is dissimilar in the human being. But they are both two single aspects of the one single process. In Eckhart's doctrine concerning the relationship between the divine being and the created being, this antinomy, we find the antinomy, which was already present in Neoplatonism, in the categories of abstraction, aphidesis, and negation, apophasis. Entbildung indeed derives from aphidesis in a sense. But what is interesting for me is that is less, in the case of Eckhart, a translation, but sort of a transposition of the problematics of aphidesis, of abstraction, to a new context. that of the image and the form. And Bildun then names the stripping away of all images, the veiling of the soul through negative ascesis, the passage through images and mental copies. Then again, why? What was wrong with these images? In a context like the biblical provision of images, it was a tendency to think that given God's invisibility, images were considered a wrong medium to establish a contact with Him, with the divine. And that leads to negative theology, of course, and radically involves language. For the aniconist, the people against images, there is the risk of idolatry. Images idolize the world and blind the eyes to looking beyond the world and focusing on the Creator. To prohibit the production of images means, therefore, to prohibit the adoration of the visible world in a monotheistic context. But Christianity readmitted images. Images of the visible are and images of the invisible. That's why Eckhart developed his ethics of image, a live sort of mystical experience, or better, an spiritual exercise of a meditative kind. The intellect's only choice to rise itself towards a direction, a direct intuition of transcendence. The loss and disimagining of the world is equivalent here to setting in inside the being through which the world exists. Okay, it is clear that Eckhart relies on Neoplatonic sources to develop this theory of the image. That is why it's a sort of his idea of conceptual reformulation of Neoplatonism in this sense, and it is very clear from this passage. When a master creates an image out of wood or stone, he does not insert the image into the material. Rather, he removes the shavings, in the case of wood, that had hidden and covered the image. He adds nothing to the wood. On the contrary, he strips away and extracts what covers the image. He removes the dross. What shines through is what was hidden beneath it. Let's confront or compare this passage with Plotinus. But how? This is a very famous passage. Perhaps I don't have to read it, but just a few hints. How are you to see into a virtuous soul and know its loveliness? Withdraw into yourself and look. And if you don't find yourself beautiful yet, act as does the creator of a statue that is to be made beautiful. He cuts away here, he smooths there, and so on, and so far. Remember Michelangelo also saying something quite similar. And remember, if you were yesterday here, the opposite direction, what Professor Masahiro Morioka suggested, a sort of Copernican turn to think that what is hidden is the essence. Here we are in the other opposite direction. It is clear then that for Eckhart, this theory of image can be translated into ontological terms: model, image, being, and what causes being. But what interests Nishitani Keiji in his work, most famous, Suke to Wananika, Religion and Nothingness, is not this relation between being and being created, but he put the emphasis on the poor nihilum of the creator that shares the nothingness with the Godhead, the essence of the divine, of God. In this quotation, we can see how Nishitani refers to Eckhart's theory of image. I quote, "Eckhart names the essence of God that is free of all form, completely image-free, bildos, Godhead, as nothingness. In the case of Eckhart, the nothingness in which God's ground is my own and my ground is God's own is the field that brings about a personal relationship between God and man. It is on this field of nothingness that the actual form, the visible form or build of everything that exists, including God, comes to light. Only in this nothingness is everything that is represented as God or soul and the relationships between them made possible." End of quote. And what I would like to suggest here is that Nishitani sees Eckhart's ontology, or perhaps better, ontophany of the image, as a standpoint analogous to what happens in the field of emptiness, as a way to overcome precisely the paradox of representation. Let us see another passage of the work. As the saying goes, a bird flies and it is like a bird. A fish swims and it looks like a fish. The selfness of the flying bird in flight consists of its being like a bird. The selfness of the fish as it swims consists of looking like a fish. Or put the other way around, the likeness of the flying bird and the swimming fish is nothing other than their true sadness. On these fields of emptiness, modern man's standpoint of subjective self-consciousness, which have been opened by Kant's Copernican revolution, has to be revolutionized again. In this passage, Nishitani identifies likeness with suchness, how a being appears and how it is. He claims that the two coincide in a field that goes beyond the standpoint of subjective self-consciousness, characteristic of modernity, and opened up by Kant. Why? He starts the work asking what is religion, where does it come from? Then he asks about what is real, what is reality, and clarifies that sometimes we use, well, not sometimes, most of the time we use terms real and reality to name things that actually exist. And what happens with nihility? Nihility is already the person there sometimes, but is not existent thing or being. So he concludes, all real beings are reality, but not all reality are real beings. As the argumentation advances, Nishitani claims that the standpoint of emptiness makes it possible to enter into real contact with the reality of things. That is, things in themselves, an expression that recalls the Kantian Ding an sich, the noumenon, can be known. The contrary direction that takes Kant when in his Critique of Pure Reason argues that the impossibility to have knowledge of the thing in itself by means of either concepts or intuitions. Nishitani does not contradict at this point, but he proposes to experience the thing in itself through a non-subjective, non-representational, and non-conceptual means, what he calls the knowing of not knowing. According to Nishitani, the problem with the standpoint of modern subjectivity is that it assumes that something lies outside subjectivity as something independent and something represented, as we can see from this quote. On the field of consciousness, things are all received as objective entities by self-conscious ego, posited as a subjective entity. Things are set in opposition to consciousness as external actualities. This is so because the very possibility of things being viewed externally already implies the field of consciousness. Even to say that something merely that it lies outside of subjectivity is still an act of subjectivity. An object is nothing other than something that has been represented as an object. And even the very idea of something independent of representation can only come about as a representation. This is the paradox essential to representation, and hence an object as well, an aporia inherent in the field of consciousness itself. Of course, Nishitani was not the only one to notice that paradox, but according to his standpoint, since subject and object are correlative terms, subject is always of an object and an object for a subject, he criticizes the whole Western philosophical tradition for having thought always beings and existence in terms of the category of substance or subject. And proposes his own sort of solution to this paradox. The same problem, the problem started with Descartes, of course, then Kant tried to, well, of course, not so obviously, but for the time being, of course. And then Kant, as Nishitani recognizes, marked a milestone in the awareness of the subject, because Kant contended that the object must conform to the constitution of subjectivity and its self-consciousness, so it was a step further. But even in this way, Kant was not able to solve this paradox of representation. And it is not only that the problem of representation entails that we cannot enter in doubt or encounter the reality of things in itself, as Nishitani says. It also, what is at stake is a sort of anthropocentrism, as I think is very clear from this passage in Heidegger's The Age of the World Picture, a work that was published at the time that Nishitani was studying in Freiburg with Heidegger. Heidegger is also dealing with the problem of representation. He confronts the Greek sense of representatio, Latin, with Vorstellen in modernity, and says representation as Vorstellen means to bring the person at hand before one as something standing over and against, to relate it to oneself, the representer, and in this relation to force it back to oneself as the norm-given domain. When this happens, man puts himself in the picture concerning beings, in the center. And this entails this, that all knowledge comes to be a doctrine of man, an anthropology. In this sense, anthropology means that philosophical interpretation, we could say, which explains and evaluates beings as a whole from the standpoint and in relation to man. For Nishitani, this can also be a problem. He calls this self-centerism, self-egocentrism, or self-centeredness. And the problem reaches its critical moment with nihilism. After Kant, especially with existential philosophies, again, a step further, the paradox of representation is done, but a step further away, but still is there. Now things and subject becomes nothingness, are nullified. So then what happens? There is no problem at all? Has been it solved? According to Nishitani, the problem is not still resolved because it enters merely a negation. The only field where the paradox of representation can be solved is, according to him, the field of emptiness. Emptiness, I quote him, is the real form of reality. Real form as such is a non-form. We have here the formless. Only in its non-form does a fact become manifest as a fact. The real form of all things, including man, comes to be a double exposure of life and death. All living things can be seen under the form of death without thereby being separated from the proper form of life. The real appearance of these things must be seen at the ground to rest on the basis of absolute being, seeing soku nothingness, nothingness soku being, or the absolute non-duality of life and death. So, an emptiness, I think, is neither a phenomenon that appears to us, nor a noumenon unknowable to us. It's pure likeness, the flying of a bird that looks like a bird. The mode of being, he calls think being itself. Like in the next passage, the man moving his limbs, the clouds floating across the sky, the water flowing, the leaves falling, or actions, processes, not substances or subjects or objects. the blossoms scattering are all non-form. Their form is a form of non-form. Musonoso. To adopt this form of non-form as a form of the self is precisely what is meant by the standpoint of observance. Now, comes the idea that to adopt this standpoint of emptiness implies a sort of practice, a religious practice, an observance. Nishitani's standpoint here may recall as Hawaiian Buddhism, as I mentioned before. And precisely, Nishitani uses Buddhism, I think, to criticize Western metaphysics. In Religion and Nothingness, particularly, is concerned with the one-dimensional relationship of correspondence in Western epistemology and traditional ontology, relating a thing with a concept. Similarly to Heidegger in the text mentioned while he was discussing the concept of truth as aletheia, as self-disclosure, instead of correspondence of adequatio. So, of course, there is a Buddhist background here, but what I would like now to clarify is to what extent can we relate this with Enbildung, with this imagination in Eckhart. Of course, is up to now obvious that Nishitani uses here paradoxes, negations, to suggest how is this the thing in this field of nothingness. But he recalls also Nishida when he says that the expression of the form of non-form or the sound of the soundless is the lies at the foundation of Eastern culture. On the one hand, Nishitani's thought on imagination and expression also deal with religion and art in the same direction. They refer to a kind of practice that comes very close to what Eckhart intends with Enbildung. Let's see to what extent I say so. The starting point for Nishitani clearly is impermanence. In several texts, but in particular in the anthology edited by Ueda, Shukyo Tohi Shukyo no Aida, in the essay on Basho, Nishitani argues that impermanence is a universal experience, but where Greek and Christianity see an eternal, immutable, and incorruptible being, in Asia, or East Asia, especially in Buddhism, this impermanence has no basis for change, or nor as an expectation, religious expectation of salvation. When one grasps, he says, and welcomes something impermanent, and is used to happen in the context of Buddhism, this impermanence, together with a profound feeling of sadness and emotion, happens. So this is where the pathos of the expression, or the how the things express themselves, the mono no aware in poetry, appears. For Nishitani, this particular essay, we can find this kind of practice in poetry, in haiku poetry. In the case of Basho is very clear. Basho is able, so to speak, to make the inversion where the nihility and the nullity of things, the impermanence and contingency, can be overcome, an inversion where nihility of things is seen as, regarded as something that can be positive. As the typical or the traditional formulation of the Horn Sutra says, form is emptiness, but emptiness is form. In this standpoint of emptiness, we are rid of all form. Reality is at hand as it is. But we can only get in touch with the reality of things through action or praxis. And it is here only when the standpoint of representation has passed beyond. in religious and nothing, in religion and nothingness, called this uses the religious term observance, or also action of non-action, because this way of living entails that is not nothing that the self does, it's something that happens to the observant. But and the way of poetry, the way of haiku, waka, renga, he mentions also this ceremony. He discusses the word to practice, means also to go, gyo or iku, it's the same character, and devotes the entire essay to this problem. Also in Kutosoku, mentions how arts can become ways, can become ways of practice in this same regard. Let's see a particular example of his reading of Basho that includes this sense of observance, religious, so to speak, observance, but also is concerned with beauty, that is our topic here. What does it mean to encounter the national flower? This passage is speaking about how happens this encounter with the reality of things. The example is this tiny flower. When a national flower blooms, it means that the first petals are emerging from the plant. Well, I have to say that this is my translation, so sorry if it's not natural English. It is a simple event, but in Basho's case, this flower, which needless to say is so small that it goes unnoticed, shines in a moment, in that moment, with a kind of beauty. So to speak, as a flower that shines, it should strike attention. In a sense, such a small flower that shines, as a small flower, is not inferior to beautiful flowers such as lilies or roses. Rather, it shines as if it were a precious stone of a beauty that we don't know but is present. She shines urging Basho, with the poet, and makes herself present to his spirit. When one looks at beauty in the flower of Nazuna, it is not beauty in the normal sense of the world. This means that the flower of Nazuna emerges into a place where it cannot be called beautiful in the normal sense of the beauty of the lily and rose, manifests itself invested with the light of poetry. Here, in fact, if Basho would not have overcome the prospect of normal aesthetic judgments, such as the rose is beautiful and the Nazuna is not, see here the representational point of view, or the paradox, and if Basho would have not overcome the perspective of normal consciousness and self-consciousness, this beauty of the Nazuna flower would not have manifest itself. Ultimately, if we want to say at this point what this scene, by just understanding of seeing a thing, the encounter with a thing, it is a manifestation of things in front of us as figures of their true being as they are, or rather a manifestation of things within the way of being as it is. Well, in Kutosoku, and Ishitani gives more examples of how the practice of poetry in haikai allows to express this sort of encounter, to enhance how things manifest themselves in this field of emptiness, to who is able to see properly to them. He mentions, for example, ways of overcoming the objective and representational way of expressing reality with haiku kire, the Kire Suzuki, and the notion that Ohashi Ryosuke has proposed as a Japanese aesthetic category to express a characteristic artistic and natural beauty. He speaks also about the ability of poetry in Japan to express language and muteness, the reciprocal permeation of silence and words with the particulars, the particles, for example. But what I would like to mention as an example that Nishitani does not use, but I think he has in mind when especially in the quotations I put before, is a rhetorical strategy that Dogen, Mr. Zen Master Dogen, uses, is a rhetorical strategy called mitate. Mitate means to suggest, to infer, an element B which is absent through an element A that is present. It consists of recalling something in absentia by means of something in presentia. This process can be carried out successfully only through intuition, through imagination, through connection between the two elements and the capacity of the poet and the reader to have this sensibility. Dogen, for example, composes this strophe. Italian scholar Aldo Tolini puts different examples of Dogen's use of mitate, and this is one of them. Water is clear to the bottom, and fishes swim just like fishes do, this recalls Nishitani. The sky is vast and extends as far as the heaven. Birds fly just like birds do. Exactly the same standpoint, but what is interesting here is that Dogen uses mitate not as a metaphor or a symbol, but to deconstruct symbol or metaphor. Because for Dogen there is not a separation or opposition between what is absent and what is present. Dogen wants to remove all delusion. Fishes and birds here obviously refer to the enlightened person. But for Dogen, are not merely that metaphor. Mitate in Dogen, which is based in dissimilarity and similarity of the image and the real thing, in the same way that Eckhart and Wilton works, with similarity and dissimilarity are the theoretical basis, is used in Dogen to deconstruct mitate itself, the same image. It's a process, so to speak, of inbuilding. Since for Dogen, nothing is a shade of something else, for all is the true being. And I think I would say that Nishitani shares the same view when talking about bird that flies and looks like a bird and fishes, etc. It's very clear in this passage. This is Nishitani again. The sadness of the bird consists in the fact that the bird flies and it is like a bird. Seems that is quoting Dogen, but it's not said in the text. This is the mode of being of who stands on that field of emptiness. Let's go to the italics at the end. The identity of being and knowing is more primal than traditional metaphysics has taken it to be. The same way that Dogen uses mitate to deconstruct mitate, here this coincidentiality between lightness and sadness is a way to overcome or deconstruct the paradox of representation and metaphysics itself. Now I move into the conclusions, because the consequence for this kind of, we could say, way of living or experiencing reality through practice and observance is freedom, is the fearless action, the fearless flight of a bird gliding across the sky without a moment's hitch, unburdened. This is the playful attitude of who is free. Like the bird that leaves no tracks along the path of its flight, there's nothing left behind. There's no basis, no ground. It's another way to overcoming the metaphysical tradition that separates both things. Then, to conclude, I would say that Nishitani remains within the horizon of Asian non-dualistic tradition when distinguishes between emptiness and form, because since they, of course, are two dimensions, are of the same process, are phases of polarity differentiated but correlative, never separated of one unique process in continuous transition. Therefore, in this sense, Nishitani's standpoint shares what we call the post-foundational metaphysics, in the sense that tradition that emerges in the wake of Heidegger's critique of metaphysics and says that the acceptance of the inescapable contingency of existence is an emancipatory possibility substituting being for notions as the abyssal ground. My suggestion then here is that the self-emptying standpoint of emptiness as a negation of negation can be seen also as a new interpretation or reinterpretation of Entbildung, but again in the same case as in Eckhart, not as mere translation, but as a transposition of a problem, a same problematics but in a new context. Here the context is form and formless. And then, as Wackernagel, the scholar that deals with Eckhart theory of image, as Wackernagel says, Entbildung constitutes, or this imagination, is a way of experiencing a certain detachment from the predominant cultural and mental structures, but without destroying them. And this is why I wanted to show the background of Buddhist and Christian tradition, because it's there, I think, behind Nishitani's statements, but in a new space, in a new passion, perhaps. This imagination, in this sense, may help us to ensure the necessary degree of spiritual serenity, as Wackernagel puts, and inner freedom that guarantees the establishment of what he calls a sort of transcultural point of view of symbiophilosophy. But I would say this can be expressed in another terms, like the savage region, the wild region that Merleau-Ponty talk about, sort of place where our predominant cultural and mental structures are detached from us. But last, turning to Ueda. He wrote that what is important in the experience of beauty is the movement of the existence, never reducible to fixed images. He spoke of beauty as a movement of the becoming. Perhaps it's German expression, the translation of Entbildung. The becoming without a trace into nothingness. In Buddhism, he says, beauty is permeated by sadness. As we have seen, it qualifies emptiness. That is, to be freely just as such. On the occasion mentioned at the beginning, Ueda entered into a dialogue with the artist in the manner of the linked verses in Renku or Renga, where one poet enters into a world that has been construed, destroys it, and then creates a new world. This sort of dialogue, artistic dialogue, a sort of recreation or perpetual process, recalls the cosmic process mentioned at the beginning as well. Coincidentally, the work Ueda created has been exhibited this year in the new Haas lectures, because the artist Fernando Prats keep it to remember that occasion. I conclude then with those eloquent images of his footsteps and his open arms as my tribute to Ueda today. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm sure there are many questions. questions coming. I just want to say one thing at the beginning. The images with which she began and now ended her talk remind me how often meeting a person in an event like this is more powerful than reading their texts. And it can cause a kind of turn in your thinking that no amount of reading or writing or studying or debate can do. There are certain key moments in life, real turning points. And I think this was a turning point for Ueda himself to discover the audience and the interest and the particular standpoint of the Spanish people who invited him. And it was a turning point for many of the people who were involved at that time. So there's a kind of aesthetic in philosophy that is not just the beauty of the prose or the tightness of the argument, but there's an aesthetic in the individual who lives it out spontaneously in a moment and communicates sometimes much more of his philosophy than we were able to see simply reading the surface of the text. I say that because we just finished a memorial service to Ueda, as Dr. Russo mentioned, and it's still emotionally very much a part of me. So. Anyway, the floor is open for questions. Yes, Grant.
Raquel, can you go back to that slide?
The slide with the quote from the Zen machine about the earth and the water. The actual of that ago.
This one?
Yeah. Because one of the things I noticed in all the passages from Nishitani that you put up, and also in the way you put the conclusion at the end, you said the whole point is that you should just be a such, right?
Mm-hmm.
Or in Nishitani's interpretation of this, he says, well, the important part is that the fish just swims, that's its suchness, right? That's what it is. Or the bird just flies, that's what it is. Or there's the example of the flower, mm-hmm. right? And what I noticed in all of these things is that even this translation, they just focus on the content.
Yeah.
You know, they're all interested in the fish. A fish swims just like fishes. See, this person has added dew. But it doesn't really say that. It just says the water is clear to the bottom, and fishes just swim like fishes. There's an emphasis on actually the context, the water. You know. And the last thing I'll say about this, so that you can comment, is there's three lines in the Genjo Koan, in Gilgen's, text. You know, he says, no matter how far a fish swims, it doesn't come to the end of the ocean. You know, no matter how far a bird flies, it doesn't come to the end of the sky. So the point is the context. The fish is the manifestation of the water being clear right to the bottom. Mm-hmm. The emphasis isn't on the fish swimming and being itself. You know, that's the weird thing I didn't really understand in Nishitani. He emphasizes always what he sees in the middle, but then all the examples he used are meant to be pointing, I thought, to the context, that the content is just the expression of the context around it. Anyway, I don't know what you think about that. Maybe it's crazy, but it's something I noticed.
Oh, it makes sense. Thank you. I added in the footnotes, plenty of them, some other passages of Dogen, and precisely the perspective or context is important for him, and human beings are not fishes or birds, but Nishitani uses the same idea or quotation to express how we can learn from the pine tree and the bamboo becoming them. So it seems that we could be as fish flying or bird flying or fish swimming, if we could be as such without in our own context, probably. But again, I wonder if this
use of poetry is a limitation for philosophical thinking, in a way, or is a way to evoke poetically what cannot be expressed. Doing perhaps in this case is clearer? What do you think?
It's worth thinking about. It was just something I think. I think that's a good point, though.
Okay. Thank you.
That was a great talk. I really enjoyed it.
John?
Mic is on.
Yes, just another comment to add to this book. Very fascinating what you both said and clarified a lot for me. Not quite as much as if I were walking into that magnificent space that you all were situated in, but still. So you're reading this thing, you know, this is about the content, and I think you, Graham, even said, if I heard you right, that in this passage, the fish are manifesting the water. Okay. So another thing that I see going on here is that there's an emphasis on what we would call the activity, the flying and the swimming. We don't just have a thing, already a fixed essence, which does a particular activity, a fish that swims, as if those two were separate, or a bird that flies, but flying is the nature of the bird, and swimming is the nature of the fish. So there's this shift to the thing as activity, which has always fascinated me in Nishitani, and it also shows up in his interpretation of what it means to say that fire does not burn fire. Fire is not something that's the activity. Anyway, both of those really helped me understand Dogen and Nishitani a lot better. I thank you.
Thank you, Paul.
How about relating what you just said, that it's not just that the fish swims or the bird flies, but flying is the bird? You quoted a passage here to say that in the human case, thinking is being human. Why do you think he chose thinking rather than feeling or imagining or so what flying is to a bird and what swimming is to the fish, he seems to say thinking is to human being.
I think it was related in the context of the work with the discussion about logos and the koto, which I mentioned before, about becoming a bamboo, becoming a pine tree. How can you, again, have access to reality? And through logos, in a representational way, you are detached. You're something always external. And first time I read it, I wonder, but how can you become this thing? It comes from Nishida as well, is the idea of perhaps not contemplated, but the same with the example of the Nazuna. Instead of projecting your own views, instead of self-centering your image of the thing, just try to learn how it is in the appropriate context. I think Thomas Casuli put example of how this becoming a bamboo or a pine tree can be applied to everyday life. And at the end of the book, Engaging Japanese Philosophy, he gives the example of technicians who were developing the video recorder, you remember? And there was a technical problem that no Western could solve, but the Japanese technicians or engineers were just looking at the pieces into the videotape in order to understand how they work. And finally, one came up with the idea, oh yes, this should be in this way. because it's natural for that thing to do this thing. So in that sense, I can see how logos is overcome. Even thinking is something that is natural for us is a characteristic of human being, of course. Thinking and language, logos is both. But this capacity of have empathy or overcoming sometimes these abilities to get a more real touch with reality, I think it's also a need. There's nothing wrong with reason, language, or logos, but we should be detached from it from time to time, I think.
First Dagmar, and then you who is carrying the microphone.
Thank you, Roger, for your lecture. Maybe you can turn to the side of the poem, this poem from Mishitani. I would like to have a question about this poem, this poem.
Is this one, I think?
Another one.
I think it was that one. Yeah. Suzuki, perhaps?
No.
Nishitani is this one,
right? Yes, I see the involvement. Yes, so I'm thinking about the term of the form, because you see, in our European, Indo-European speech families, language families, we have several terms for the form. It has difficult and different meanings for it. For example, we can choose the form as the Greek term eidos. Mm-hmm. It has another meaning than, for example, physis in Greek. And I think in the Japanese language it's the same case, because I looked at my dictionary and there is a keiko, for example, and kata. And I see you use another kanji. Yeah. I didn't find it in the dictionary. Yeah, no, it wasn't this slide.
It is Sugata, for example.
Here
it is Su. Yeah, there are several.
Maybe you can explain what is the difference between the term form, because it makes, I think, a big difference what is a formless form.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We have to see what is form, in which way we think about form, and then we can think about the formless form.
Mm-hmm. Yes, thank you. Complex question to answer, and that is why at the beginning I said, well, I understand here image and form, or image and word, I don't know where I put it, as ways of representing and expressing reality, determinate and delimited ways of doing this. Because semantic field is enormous and huge, and so and the problematic of image is different from how the problematic of words and viewers are different things, different connotations, of course, with a long history behind. In the case of Nishitani, it helps to clarify the way he uses the terms, that for me, his uses of image is still a work in progress, so I'm trying to identify all the terminology he uses in different writings. But in the case of Shuketo Bananikan, General Nothingness, is easier because if you go to the English translation by Jan Ambrach, he clarifies in the glossary at the end all the possibilities that he found in the work and how he uses in his translation this capital letter as the only way to mark the difference between forms. In what case is the Buddhist form, the real form of things, appearance, or the way they manifest themselves. And in the same case, he uses the capital letter for Nishitani's expression, form of non-form, or formless form, if you like. But he uses other terms, always the same term, form, but without capital letter, and sometimes he applies adjectives, like real forms or two forms, to distinguish between the kanjis. So it's a good source to start doing this research for clarification. I cannot see in the whole of Nishitani's writings for now, up to now, a consistency. It depends on the world you are looking at. But for example, when he's referring to image, same term in German, uses different kanji. So it would take time to look at it carefully in detail to give you a proper answer. Thank you.
I'm preparing to sit down so that I will become a part of the audience. Thank you for the paper that you delivered, and it answered some of the questions that I have with my own research. I'm just wondering, just to continue the question or even the comment of Father Harry said a while ago, when we said that the birds, they fly, the fish, they swim. So what should the human beings do? We abstract, we think, we represent. And Paul Ricoeur, in his hermeneutics, would be saying that it is not really possible for the human being, for the human person, to know himself, to know his own self immediately, or in an immediate intuition. It's only possible via the long route of going through texts. So going through historical texts, going through personal texts, meeting other people, similar to what Father Heisigel said in the beginning, when we actually encounter people, everything changes in us. Then we begin to understand ourselves. And it always becomes a problem for me, because Nishida even would be saying that it has to be an immediate intuition of this elemental life. This the field of emptiness allows us to immediately see ourselves without any images, without any representation. So what would you comment on that? If you could comment on that, it would be great. I would be grateful. Thank you.
Thank you for your question. Well, as I said, I think that there is nothing wrong with thinking representationally or with images at all. And it depends on the context, and it depends on the way you use those words, images, and thinking, and in what situations. I mean, precisely what Nishitani tries, I think, is to philosophize about those limits of representation itself. So not to abandon reason for irrationality, or to say we should all write poetry and become poets or painters in order to get into reality. It's not saying that we should give up philosophy for art. But art and religion seem to be places where there is this freedom of expression that is not in the common language, or the way we use language, or the way we use our way of thinking, our thought. For example, the same notion of Bildung can become a concept, precise term. But at the same time, it's a process. It's something that entails a spiritual exercise. So behind that concept, there must be a lived experience. But we cannot just experience and then not talk. There is always this balance between experiencing and then trying to understand that experience. Interpreting it through language, through words, to philosophy, hermeneutics, the tools we have. But if we only attach to fixed images, fixed concepts, fixed ideas and ideals, we get wrong, because we fall into idolatry. It's a religious term, but it can be used also in other senses, for politics or for everything in our lives. The problem is the attachment, the fixation. When you achieve a truth and you cannot move forward, in reality is changing, and impermanence, again, is important here. The process of building this imagination or the construction in philosophy is or negative theology even, is radically to put us in front of our limitations and the limits of reason and words, and let us be more conscious that there are other dimensions in life that are not attainable only through that. This is why there is art and religion.
Questions? Yes, please.
あの先ほど の, あの道元の引用されたあの詩の部分ですけれど、これは、西谷さんの本からの、あの引用ですか、それとも道元の直接のテキストからの引用ですか。ちょっと道元のオリジナルと少し違っているので、あのオリジナルを書きますね。
He said it's slightly different from the original. This Japanese, the Chinese you have up there, if you don't mind, I'd like to write the original on the board.
Water is clear to the bottom. This is a kind of suffix, no special meaning. And water goes slow and slow. Fish goes slow and slow. The sky is vast without limit. Suffix. A bird flies far and far.
Thank you. Well, as Ihan says, this is from Genjoku. Pasikon in Shogenso?
Shogenso no 75 巻の時とからです。これそのものが、和自然史の詩から道元が引用したものです。で、道元がこれについていろんなコメントをして、それは大変興味深い。
So this is a quote that Dogen took from a Chinese master. Wang Xi, I think. Yes, Wang Xi.
Yes, I took also the original one. Yes. Yeah. Indeed, Dogen wrote this in the slide as a comment to Wang Xi's poem.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Any other questions? Well, yes. Good. One final question. Good. Yes.
You sketched a definition of aesthetics at some point, which was quite precise, but you didn't develop, I think. When you were talking about Borobudur temple, I think you said can be you said which is totally adequate for what I can imagine that aesthetics we have to resituate aesthetics in its context of origin, and you aptly said that there are limited it's a limited we have to be conscious of its limitations, etc. But and then you put it you said that Borobudur was at the same time could be seen as both aesthetical and interesting from the senses, right?
Perception, yes.
So can you explain the distinction between aesthetics and the sense? Appreciation, you said appreciation.
Perhaps it's the pronunciation. Aesthetical, aesthesis, as a sort of discipline.
Aesthetical?
Yeah, sort of. All right. Etymologically related with aesthesis. And that's why, because as most of Buddhist images have this function.
Sorry,
because my pronunciation.
So we are exactly at 90 minutes. Well, thank you very much. This is very awesome.